Call the meeting to order, 7:00. First order of business would be to congratulate Mr. Sharp.
Next order of business? I did win opposed.
And thank Mr. Sharp.
And then, and note that our newest member, Jan Laska, is engaged elsewhere this evening and unable to make the meeting, so he did send notice that he would not make it tonight, but we'll plan to be there from now on, so. We have the minutes of April 7th, 2016. Or we don't?
No, you do.
No, I know.
Move to approve the minutes of April 7th, 2016.
Second that.
Any comments or changes? Hearing none. All in favor?
Aye.
It's unanimous. Financial statement and warrants?
So yes, tonight you have 11 warrants in front of you for your signatures that total $160,156.70. Right now, we are good. We are looking good to finish the year with one little exception. Our steamer, our pressure steamer in the kitchen died. It was at the end of its life. It wasn't worth repairing. And we have a quote here to replace it in the amount of $12,732.30. That does not include the plumbing and the electrical that's also needed to install. And I'm guessing with those two functions, we're going to be close to the $15,000 range. I printed out the quote if anybody would like to see it. What I'm proposing is that we use year-end monies to pay for this, if any, and I'm asking permission that if we don't have enough year-end monies, to use school choice money to make the difference up in the cost of the whatever we don't have in our regular budget savings.
What exactly does this piece of equipment do?
It's a steamer, so it does all the vegetables, all the rice. It's the healthiest way of cooking for our students.
For $12,000.
Yeah, it's a big piece of equipment. It really is.
It's not a George Foreman steamer.
It's not a George Foreman grill. We can't function without it.
Right.
Unfortunately, they're going in different schools because all the schools were constructed around the same time and the equipment. It's like when you buy all of your appliances at the same time, they all go at the same time. That's what we're starting to see in the district.
I can tell you that I looked at our school choice so far this year, and we had originally thought that at the end of the year we would be in the negative, but with last year's money coming in higher, we're going to have about $98,000 left at the end of the year. But then looking at our projection for next year, bringing that $98,000 forward, right now it's looking like we may get about $30,000 more in the revenue. So if we were to take out the $15,000 and also add in the cost of the kindergarten teacher you approved, we would still have $42,000 sitting in this account with the additional kindergarten teacher and buying the pressure steamer if we needed to.
Mm-hmm. Your initial recommendation tonight is to first use
any savings
going into June.
What our savings are, if we have any money, and use that first. But if we don't have enough, to then use some school choice funds.
Mm-hmm.
Isn't that the only option?
Well, unless Santa brings us one for Christmas.
Can't wait until Christmas.
But I'm saying, when you say that's your recommendation, I'm just saying, is there another recommendation? Is there another option? No.
Well, we don't replace it, but then our kids are getting, you know, boiling bag vegetables, which isn't very good.
There's a third option, which would, or another option, which would be to submit a request to the Finance Committee and Select Board for...
What's that? Free cash.
Well, no, they have a $80,000 or $50,000 quote reserve for emergency needs.
Do they now?
Yes. We've never bothered them with it because of school choice over the years. But there's an ability, if you're on an emergency basis having to spend outside of what was appropriated, you could submit to the Finance Committee and Select Board a request. And then Finance Committee would take it under advisement and say yes or no, and you can go from there. I'm just saying that, David, you're asking if there's another option there. There is a third option that can go through the Select Board and Finance Committee.
I do.
It does delay the process, though.
Right. Well, I do get a little nervous with the school choice because our school choice is our sped emergencies. Mm-hmm. I mean, we could have anybody move in over the summer with an IEP that we have to, you know, that we will have to fund. And $47,000, that's one sped emergency. So it does cause me some concern if we had to do that. Mm-hmm. So what would be your recommendation? Because I'd get nervous if we had some money left over in June and we're still asking them for money, then they might get upset with us.
Well, I would use them. Sorry.
No, go ahead.
Seems like you would use the June money, that whatever's left over, but if we don't have enough, then you would ask.
Ask them for the remainder.
Especially the argument about, because we've already dipped into school choice more than we traditionally like to do.
Okay, so we'll wait till June,
I would,
and then...
wait to June to see what the ultimate impact is. Okay. I'd like to see what we're able to find in the budget from this year. And that means I know it's typically is spent on supplies and things for next year, so I need to know the impact on that. The other plans too, so.
Do you know what the turnaround time is for getting the equipment?
There's a lead time of 6 to 8 weeks to order it. That's the only other problem. So we want to order it in, you know, getting close to the end of June, so that it's in August. It's in the building for August when we start in September.
Is it dead now?
No.
Oh, okay. So it's dying.
Oh no, it's dead.
It's dead. It's not being used.
We bought a small piece of equipment that we can use for other events, and we're trying to get by with that right now because we don't do a lot of hot lunches at this time of the year, so we're doing the smaller batches. And it's also something that when the PTO has an event or something, they can use that smaller piece of equipment as well.
Okay. Well, why don't we...
Is it possible to, I know it's asking more work, but it's possible to get another quote just in case?
This was the lowest of three.
Oh, you did? Okay, sorry.
So, I did. I think we could, I don't think we need to take a vote.
No.
It wasn't necessarily on the agenda. It's just covered under finance. But the sentiment would be bring us back a recommendation in June.
Okay.
And I'll reflect that in the minutes as well.
Mm-hmm. And before I come back in June, if I look like I have enough money to cover it, can we go ahead and order it before we come back in June?
I would say yes.
Yeah. You mean enough money to cover it in its entirety?
Yes.
In the budget.
In the budget.
Yeah. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Because I may come up with the 12 and then we'll just use next year's building maintenance to get it installed, because by the time it gets here, it'll be July, August.
Mm-hmm. Makes sense to me.
Sounds good. Thank you.
Sound good?
Yeah.
Okay. All right. So that takes care of financial statements and warrants?
Yep. Unless anybody has a question.
No questions. Public comment.
Yes.
Somewhere. Yes, I know.
Hi.
Someone's here.
Yes, I'm here. It's nice to see everybody here. I've submitted this letter. I think you guys probably already have a copy of it. If you want copies, I have some extra ones.
Okay.
We can share.
I just wanted you to have a thought.
So dear school committee members, administration, and Deerfield community, this letter has been approved by the members of the Deerfield Elementary Teachers Association. We've also shared the letter with Ms. Heil and Mrs. Barrett prior to this meeting. We acknowledge administration's efforts to examine the role of the assistant principal. After conversations between association leaders and administration regarding the recent announcement of the restructured assistant principal position, we are left with questions and concerns that we hope can be clarified. What were the driving factors that motivated the restructuring of this position to specifically include a behavior analyst? How will the restructuring of the AP position impact current teaching positions in the building? It is our understanding that this will be a 12-month position. Part of the summer responsibilities will include overseeing the summer programs. If the summer programs include students from all over the district, will Deerfield Elementary's budget be absorbing the full financial responsibility? We hope this person has extensive teaching experience and is an educational leader so he or she can effectively and fairly evaluate other teachers, run 504 and IEP meetings, administer MCAS, and perform other administrative duties. We hope in the event that the pool of candidates is not strong, this position will be reposted with a broader scope in terms of a skill set. For example, greater years of teaching experience and fewer narrow-scoped certifications, so that applicants will have a broader educational background to serve the diverse function of an AP position. We hope the makeup of the interview team will be open to a large and diverse group of faculty and staff to speak to the diverse role of the elementary school assistant principal. We believe including faculty and staff input in major decisions, such as the new assistant principal position, is an opportunity to build a stronger climate and culture at Deerfield Elementary School. Thank you for your time and consideration, the membership.
Thank you for that. I mentioned I had seen it earlier in the day, so I was aware of it. We don't really have the position per se on the agenda this evening. We do have a budget update, which I would assume we'll cover some of this, but I don't know if the administration has anything to say in response or.
Well, we did meet with our union representation for about an hour and a half, 2 hours last week, and these concerns were brought forward to us at that time. I thought we had answered their questions pretty fully.
Thank you. Is there any other public comment this time? I don't mean to bypass it. It's just we don't have it on the agenda per se as a topic. And so I don't have answers for you right now. But we will certainly work to get answers for you.
So that will be coming back on the agenda next time? Or
I think.
Well, there's a process in place. An email has gone out to all the staff. Asking for volunteers to be on a search committee. A position's been posted. I believe the posting ended today. People put in whether or not they were interested in serving on the committee. There was wide interest. I believe there were 8 and 9 people selected for the search committee, which I think is an extremely large committee for an AP position, but we wanted to be fair and try to be representative. We were concerned about budget impact. That came up as far as some of the concerns about whether we were combining the position or not. You did receive, I think, 6 to 8 applications, and we have, a screening. We're going to do an initial screening because oftentimes we get positions posted on School Spring that aren't even close to being qualified. And then the committee's going to interview the candidates, and I believe you hope to have a decision within a couple of weeks.
Yep, we Communication was sent out today announcing who the members of the committee would be. As Marty said, there are nine, and we've asked them to submit three questions that they would like to pose during the interview process. I've asked Kim and Karen to be a part of that process, and the three of us will be screening out, narrowing down the questions. We also will be screening the candidates, presenting candidates to the interview committee. So we're looking at about the week of May 9th.
The only question that was here that didn't come up when we met last week was about it being a 12-month position. That was my recommendation, to have it a 12-month position, because Clay wasn't a full-year position, but he was often here on his own time during the summer. And that was a concern of mine, that we had somebody who, you know, saw a need to be here, but it was not a full-year employment. And we had no other administrative position in the district that was not a full-year position. So, and the reason that I thought would be important for having a full-year AP, one of the reasons, only one of the reasons, was that we were housing a lot of the summer programs here. And I know from my own experience at Frontier that we had so many programs at Frontier that I thought it was very important that either Darius or I be present in the building because emergencies happen. So, you know, the the burden officially has been on Janine in the past, because even though Clay was often here, he didn't have to be here. So I just thought that was one of the reasons. But there are many, that's the only time. You know, the role of a principal is so overwhelming or so self-encompassing that I found that was the only time that I had to do planning for the year. And it was really important to have an assistant principal there with you who, you know, and I use the phrase, you know, and I can only speak from my experience with Darius. He was like my house, my work husband. We chatted all summer long. We did all our planning. We did a breakdown of the year before. Otherwise, you're just catching, you know, as catch as can during the day. So that was the one thing that didn't come up in our discussion, why I felt the 12-month position was important.
And I think from a human resource perspective is that we only have one other assistant principal in our district, and they are 12 months. So why not make all our assistant principal positions the same? As for the job description, I do want to say that Janine and I and Superintendent Barrett collaborated on getting the posting to what this school needs and what and where we're moving. And she was very thoughtful and insightful as to what this building needed for this position to be successful as an assistant principal position. So I think she did a great job of identifying the needs of the building and then putting them in a new job posting.
And Karen and Kim, they were also part of those conversations as well, and you know, continue to be as we look towards next year, because you've heard us speak to you many times about the incoming students that we have in kindergarten and preschool in particular. The needs are changing. Mm-hmm. And we are having students that are coming in with social, mm-hmm. emotional, behavioral concerns, and we can't keep doing things the same. So we're looking at being innovative and looking at PBIS and how we can utilize the wonderful resources that we have in this building, because we have a lot of people with various areas of expertise. And what can we do differently to meet the needs of these students? And that's the vision that we have right now.
And I
feel like this position will meet that.
Yeah. Of course, if there were the other question came up, if it wasn't a strong candidate pool, of course, we would search elsewhere.
But the funding piece hasn't been addressed either.
Well, the funding, it's the same. Is it, like this summer, all the programs are going to be in Sunderland. That doesn't mean I'm going to take Ben Barshevsky's salary and allocate it. The programs that are run are either out of school time, which are tuition paying, or voluntary reading camps, which are teachers from all of the schools that get hired. So the teachers, so each school ends up paying their share based on the total cost of the program divided by the number of students sent. The administration really is only in the building for emergency purposes. The only other services going on in the building are Deerfield resident related, and those would be our special education summer programs, which I think also will be in Sunderland. So there is no difference in the funding piece. I don't.
But that's 1 year. It's in Sunderland.
1 year, but that
this
doesn't.
This building does go through, as we talked about before, a lot of wear and tear, and there are a lot of things that Deerfield shoulders.
But folks, we are a district.
Yes.
We are a district, and I don't want to, you know, engage in a back and forth because I know that's not appropriate at school committee.
But then my taxes pay for a piece of the summer for emergencies, and you really specified that there are emergencies and we want to have somebody here full time. Otherwise, we wouldn't have somebody here for a 12-month position, correct?
No. What I said was that it's important to have people in the building during the summer, not only for the summer programs, but for planning purposes and organizing. Teachers are coming in all the time, parents are coming in, new families are coming in. And I really, you know, sometimes we do things for the greater good. We educate all of our students in the district. If we were providing reading services and housing a program in one town as opposed to another town because of the facilities, we are doing it for all of the students in the district. That's why we have one curriculum director for the elementary, so that all of our students get access to the same high quality curriculum. We have one superintendent, one business manager. We do not have separate central offices for each of the towns. We do this for the greater good of the district.
And I don't see what costs that Deerfield is bearing that wouldn't be borne if these programs weren't here. Because you'd still have your SPED program here and children who receive SPED services over the summer. The out-of-school time program would still be here in the summer because Deerfield has the most residents. That's why we do it here. And the same thing with the reading program. I mean, it's just that Deerfield sends the most kids, so it makes the most sense that it would be in Deerfield and not ask, you know, if 50% of the students are coming from Deerfield, to ask them to go up to Conway to attend the reading and writing program, which has been very successful, the reading and writing programs in the summer. So it just makes the most common sense, but the building would still be in use, so I don't know what costs we would share with the other towns as far as that went.
Can I ask a separate budgetary issue about sort of, is it a net, we're gonna be paying more?
No, we're hoping to have savings.
We are?
Yes.
So Clay, and I guess it's public people's salaries, so we don't need to get into that specifically, but whatever Clay is making now, is that we're hoping to just extend that, you have a 10-month appointment now?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so we're just extending that over 12 months and mm-hmm. hoping that we're going to get somebody in that same
exactly
ballpark.
That would be my financial goal.
Well, okay. So, well,
we're going to get the best candidates.
Is that what we budgeted for?
Yes.
In our
yes, that's what's approved in the budget. Yes.
Okay.
So, that's why we usually budget at the mid-range. Because we would hope that we were hiring some youthful teachers, but we do hire the best candidate for the job, and then we just struggle to find, you know, some money elsewhere to, you know, if we go over what we budgeted. But I don't see this position, even at a 12-month, going over what we have budgeted
right. That
you approved.
And then it sounds like it's kind of a new position, new roles and stuff like that. Is it a assistant position / something else, or is it an assistant principal like the right center? Do you know what I mean? Is there some other
behavioral analyst?
That's what
in combination with the assistant principal.
So that's sort of be a title that carries two parts to it, or
correct?
Okay.
I was wondering, could you elaborate a little bit about the behavioral analyst? Does that combine another role in the school, or is this an additional role?
Well, I think it would depend, first of all, on the candidate, and who we have. We're certainly looking for a skill set. One of the things that Kim and Karen and I have spoken about is when you look at the state is moving towards an initiative of PBIS. A lot of the assistant principal roles across the state are changing to be able to meet the needs of these students. The students that we're having coming in is a trend. This is not something that's uncommon, the students that we have with these particular needs. So how are we doing things differently? And people who are BCBAs, it's becoming more popular. You are seeing, and Karen and Kim, you can speak to some of the meetings that you have with your colleagues at your level in terms of implementing PBIS. We will be looking to doing that next year and having a PBIS leadership team to be able to see how are we using the resources in this building, including OTPT, SLPs.
Kim, for those of us who
I was just going to say, we need some acronym definitions. Could you explain what PBIS is for
Positive
the...
Positive Behavioral Intervention Supports. So really looking at a different approach to... and this is something I will tell you, I'm not well-versed in this. The readings that we have about it, there are a lot of readings that are coming out. I'm going to a lot of meetings about it. Kim and Karen have a lot of experience with it. Kristen Robinson has experience with it. At Amherst, I've had a lot of conversations with her about that. So we're looking at this model. And you know, what's interesting is that we're doing a lot of interviewing right now for various positions that we have available. Most candidates are putting on their resumes that they have experience or training in PBIS. This is what's happening.
Can I just add that coming from two large cities that I came from, this is the trend with assistant principals, that they are the PBIS leader. The principal is the educational leader of the building, and the assistant principal is more the discipline, behavior, and it is PBIS. The larger cities have been moving towards that trend for about 5-6 years now. So I would imagine that we're going to get a wealth of candidates that have this experience, because it's what the larger cities have been doing for the past 5-6 years.
It's a natural fit for the two roles. And Kim and Karen, if you wouldn't mind jumping in a little bit and offering some of your experiences or conversations you've had.
I mean, I would love to talk a little bit, because you've heard about some of the kids coming in that we're doing a nice net and reaching our littler ones earlier and better. And we're really proud of that piece. But a piece of that also is partnering with parents and setting up supports that not only address the academic readiness piece, but the social emotional development and the behavioral development. And I feel that this is a way that we can get out ahead of things and really help steer this ship in a very positive way to support children and family that really bring some challenging issues to our classrooms, to our schools, to our community. And we have our new standards in pre-K and K that are all around social emotional development and play-based learning approaches. And they're really looking and studying and bringing in the research around the importance of this and making a shift throughout Massachusetts and nationally. And it's a really wonderful opportunity for Deerfield to take a look at this in a more global way within its community, in a more integrated way, I think. And it's exciting for me to be a part of it.
What Janine said about an educational team leader in the principal as far as really understanding the interventions, this I've said over and over that Deerfield is exceptional in its interventions academically. And from a special education perspective, what has always been said to me from the special education teachers is a lot, and it's not just a special education issue. We're seeing more and more students come in at a younger age with dysregulation, executive functioning issues that come out in their behavior. And that what we're looking to be able to do is, the way I understand it, is you need to be able to put interventions in place into a classroom. You need to be able to work with teachers to define interventions, to be able to put accommodations in place. We don't have a position anymore where it's assistant principal, and I know, Clay, you did a lot. It's not this model that we've had, but we're looking to build more on it. It's not just discipline where you send a student, say you've misbehaved, and send them down to the assistant principal, and they do their time, and when they calm down, they go back. You need to be able to really get into classrooms. You need to be able to work with the teachers. You need to be able to describe the interventions. And if I may say, it wasn't too many years ago when we defined the position of inclusion specialist. And I think it's taken a while for it to be defined in the number of years that we have it. at first because there were so many kids. I was like, that kid, you know, to be honest. And I think the school as a whole right now is really looking at tiered interventions, and people are open to say, I want to learn as a professional what accommodations and interventions should happen in my classroom. What accommodations and interventions do we have throughout the school? How do we build a tiered system of support that handles social, emotional, and behavioral issues school-wide? It's not a special education issue, it's not a classroom issue, and you build that up. And I think that's what we're looking for in the assistant principal position. I just want to take this opportunity to say that I think, you know, with the number of students where we really had to define behavioral intervention planning or targeted interventions, it's, and Tina's here, and so I want to acknowledge that it has made in this year a difference in the climate and the interaction with teachers and the cooperation of really being able to look, what do I do in my classroom? Please come in for a little bit. Let's talk about this kid. What can I do? Is building in this school right now, and it's a positive model. But we need to do something school-wide and not just an intervention from a special education perspective of really working with students. I say this constantly when I talk to Kim. When it comes to early intervention, if every student who comes in here with self-regulation issues becomes an IEP, we will not be able to maintain that. It has to be a school-wide initiative to work with and have the social-emotional component to put interventions in place.
And that's part of the conversation. I mean, that's exactly what we're looking at, trying to build capacity and teaching skills. So the traditional model of having a child come down to the principal's office or the assistant principal's office and have a consequence and call home, not real effective. So we have to look at what skills are we teaching these students, and with the goal of reducing the number of IEPs and referrals that we have, building capacity.
Do we envision this person, almost with a social worker component, going to families' homes? Did someone say something about
There could be a home component. Tina, in her current role, actually, she does a lot of home visits.
Yeah.
Yep. So we're going to do whatever the child and family needs.
Right.
That's the bottom line.
Okay. So, I have to be honest. I'm a little unclear about what the letter is really trying to get at. Like whether there's something, there's a collective worry that there is something that Clay, the assistant principal now, is doing that won't get done in a new position, or is it a worry about all of the new good stuff that we're trying to do being done in that position? And I'm not sure that I need an answer to that, but I'm just, or is it a communication issue and how this came
first
about?
First of all, I have to interject. I mean, you know, we're not going to talk about personnel issues.
No,
but,
I don't.
No, I know that. But when it is known that a position is open,
right,
you start examining how you're going to replace that person, and you look for other things that maybe you can do with that position.
Sure.
And I think that's the opportunity that presented itself in this case. Because things change. The role of the assistant principal is no longer a traditional model. And so you had that occurring. You had budgetary concerns. And then frankly, when we started to vote, when we voted the third kindergarten position in April, to me, that was sort of the push to say, is there another way we can look at this? Because we didn't budget for the third kindergarten position. We budgeted back in November for the AP position and for the behavioral analysis position. That's in the budget. But then when you have to go to a third teaching position that's not in the budget, you start to try to look at creative solutions. And that's why I want you to be careful with depleting your school choice funds, because that is our only safety net. And I said in April, your only means of paying for that third kindergarten teacher was school choice. There's not enough savings anywhere to come up with that. So is this a creative solution that we can look at coming up with a new way of looking at a position? A year from now, I'm not going to be here, but you may be examining and say, you know what? We really need an additional position to support the behaviors, because a year ago, we came to you with this position because there is a need. I'm not saying that need has gone away, but sometimes you try to get, you know, you try to be creative and come up with something. And I think, you know, I would ask Janine and the school committee, and obviously the teachers, to be examining this, because it is a loss of a position if we do this combined the way we have it. And maybe, you know, be prepared to add it to the budget. I don't have all the answers tonight. I'm guessing that teachers felt they wanted to have be part of the process, which is why they're here publicly. I thought we had answered their questions last week. And I can say that I think the process has been pretty transparent. We have a large committee. We're going to examine resumes. And this is what we do for any position that we have open in the district. It's no different than any other position.
Another question about process. So what is the committee going to be charged with? They're going to interview, and are they going to bring candidates to you?
They
just
will.
One or more than one?
Yeah. Well, you know, you always hope for a couple, two or three.
Mm-hmm.
But, and then Janine and I'll, you know, make the decision. And I also have to say, I could have just appointed somebody. I mean, you know, we're going through a very lengthy process, but I certainly could have done that. I was trying to avoid the appearance of top-down. And that was my recommendation, was to be as inclusive as possible.
Transparent.
And that's why we're going through this process.
So I'll hand out there.
If you are going to be discussing this later, that's fine. But in mentioning the school choice, I believe at the last meeting it was third and fourth grade where the positions were open. How are we looking at in terms of applicants for school choice for the coming academic year?
I don't have that information, April, right now.
I can tell you that we had, when I looked at the recommendation from last month, we had enough slots to take 20, but we only had 8 applicants. We can't make, and I'm going to be honest with you, you're going to see, and this is happening district-wide, you're going to see applicant pools for school choice dwindling because our population's dwindling. So every school is seeing fewer applications. So you have to be very careful about counting on continued school choice dollars.
Certainly at the third and fourth grade level, that's not exactly appealing time for a lot of families to be moving.
No, and I know that. And it's the same thing for, like, Frontier. They get a ton for seventh grade and nothing after that.
One last question.
It sounds like Marty just mentioned the fact that there's actually going to be a position that's dropped. Could you be more specific about that?
I didn't hear the question.
She asked about a position that's being dropped, the behavioral analyst position. I don't think it's being dropped. It just wasn't added.
No, it's not being dropped. We don't know what's going to happen with it. We do have an internal candidate, but we also have a number of external candidates as well.
Is there currently a behavioral analyst on staff?
Correct.
That's being melded into the assistant principal's position?
Not necessarily.
I think that's the question. Is the
we're saying depending on the candidate that we get and the strength of them, it could be, and like Janine said, this isn't a spike. This is a trend. So we probably will have the capacity where we need the assistant principal with it and the behavioral position that we already have to actually do the implementation, one to draw up the plans, one to implement the plans. I think that there's plenty of capacity. But once, if this trend does go, I think what the superintendent was saying is there may in the future not be the need for two positions.
So those are the positions you're talking about, not any different positions?
No.
Thank you.
I think so. Yeah.
I guess I can just speak of just maybe some follow-up that you seemed like you're kind of asking the clarity of the letter. The association leadership, we did meet with the administrators, and we met for quite some time, and we did have good conversation, and we're charged with bringing the information back to our members, and we relayed very clearly all of the information that was given to us, and then the membership still has, you know, we follow their lead, and they still wanted some clarifying questions, so that's the follow-up. So I think it was more just to continue the conversation.
Well, I would hope that the conversation would be ongoing, and we have, you said nine people?
I haven't checked today, but it was between 6 and 9.
Between 6 to 9 interested, I assume, faculty members from Deerfield Elementary School that have expressed the desire to be part of the search.
Oh, you mean for the committee? Yes, there are 9 people on the committee, correct, mm-hmm. Yes.
Is that
so.
Public
knowledge who they are?
Yes.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So. Yeah.
So she wants to know who they are.
Ah. I think many of them are here tonight. Yeah. If you want to raise your hand, who's here?
Clark, Karen
Zardino,
Danielle Lupnager, Linda
Gavin,
Lisa Gaylor,
Giselle
Richardson,
Kathy Derval. Is that 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7.
And you.
Me.
You're 8.
Lisa Gaylor.
I don't think you said
Lisa. I said Lisa
Gaylor. She did, and she said both of you. We're missing one.
Sounds like the superintendent search.
I know. It's hard to get.
Want to be inclusive and transparent, David.
But I think it's important.
Linda's on there.
Yeah, and that's what we shared too. We understand it was a big committee, but we also felt like it was a really important
Karen
position
Larry.
In our school.
Karen
Larimer.
Karen
Larimer,
yeah.
Special Education Secretary, who works very closely with the person in that role.
Okay. So. Okay. Well, I thank you for the public comment and what I hope was a worthwhile discussion. We'll try to move along. Unfinished business, the building update.
Yes, did I pass these out to you? No, I did not. I wanted to give you, this is primarily about the roof, so I should preface that. We're moving along very nicely. The general contractor bids came in under the approved construction bid of the budget of $2.341 million, and our low bidder came in at $1.598 million, a $762,000 savings, which is significant since there is...
Like 30%?
Yeah. That's the general bids were received on April 12th. The select board approved the... Another acronym, NTP, the Notice to Proceed. MD Engineering was formally released to proceed with construction, and they commenced and they're working on submittals and material procurements at this time. Construction will start on June 20th, and substantial completion is August 26th. Bob Lesko and I believe Patty are meeting with the company so that we can make sure that we get all the information to the faculty about what needs to happen. Having met with the contractor, I was pleased that he didn't make it sound like you had to cover everything or vacate things. And it was primarily the electronics that we needed to pay particular attention.
Because of dust.
Yeah, and that we would recommend that teachers take personal belongings, pictures, things like that, but that you don't have to pack up your whole classroom. So it seems like it's more normal summer preparation than we had at first expected. However, having said that, we want to give you all a list so that everybody has it and everybody's clear about what they have to do.
And that we have the materials for you to do it too, because the smart boards need to be covered.
Yes. Yeah. Plenty of plastic sheeting.
Right. Yes. Right.
So we need to order it.
So that's coming along. MDM Engineering is working on gathering all the long lead materials, submittals, nails, all that stuff. This is truly an area I know nothing about, but I'm learning a lot about roofing and expect to go into a second career when I finish. The status of the clerk position.
It's not a slate roof like you had.
I know, it's not a slate roof. I had no idea building a roof was so complicated.
Yes.
The full-time position for the clerk was posted in local newspapers, and our OPM is interviewing along with our Dick Halicheski, who's our town
building inspector.
Thank you, building inspector, to make sure that we have somebody who's agreeable. And the clerk of the works is somebody who's here. When construction is going on, they are here all day long. If construction's going for 8 hours, they're here for 8 hours. They are not popping in and popping out.
And if construction goes for 10-hour days, they're here for 10
right.
hours.
MSBA is waiting for the original board vote from Doug. Apparently, they now have that. So
the project funding agreement.
Yes.
I got the PFA today.
Yes.
Yeah.
This was done the other day.
Right.
So
no, I was just
the
PFA
is signed and approved by MSBA.
Mm-hmm. So I just wanted you to be aware of that.
If anyone on the committee wants copies of the correspondence going on between the project management team and contractors and everything, I'm more than happy to forward them along to you if you want them.
Okay. It is reams and reams.
Just call us.
Okay.
Paper.
So, I was hoping that would be the response.
The other thing I want to assure all the folks here and maybe watching at home is that the building will be done in sections, so that, and they're going to let us know what section will be first. You sort of seem to think you'd start
so in the middle and work out.
Yeah, which I thought was an interesting approach. So
it's roofing standard
work. Right. This guy's built a lot of roofs. So
this would mean that the playground is closed also.
Yes.
It does. Which is unfortunate because it's such a beautiful new playground.
All summer? What about when they finish with that end?
Well, like, there's a lot of equipment here.
Staging.
Liability.
Yeah.
Nonsense. Rope building up.
Yeah.
All over the place.
And
no ball field. Or is the ball field?
The ball field's okay.
The
ball field's okay. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So that should be fine. And I am really hoping that this weather we're having this week, it's not a predictor for
no rain.
Making up for the winter.
Rain now.
Yes.
It's come June 20th, it's gonna
yeah.
stop.
Okay.
So that's what I have.
And we have FY17 budget review.
So we just wanted to report, as you all know, that our budget was passed at town meeting, and since then we've been to two other town meetings where the Frontier budget was also accepted. So Frontier budget has also been adopted by three of the four towns. We do go to Conway on Monday night for our final town meeting. Since the last meeting that I didn't attend, you added a teacher. Thank you. I'll buy the money. As I told you earlier, I did put that in our projections for school choice, and we are projected to end 17 with about $42,000. 15 more if we don't have to use the boiler money. So we're not in great shape, but we're in better
in
shape.
The steamer.
What
oh,
did I say?
You said the boiler, and I thought, oh,
steam boiler.
Steam boiler. It's a steam boiler.
Steamer.
Okay. The boiler to run the steamer. So anyway, we're in much better position than we had been in. So I feel comfortable that, you know, it is the right decision, and financially we'll do what we have to do to make it work.
I have a question on, well, just a reflection, I guess, on the town meeting and the process and all of that. And I was disappointed in the way it played out at town meeting. For the elementary budget. I think I watched a meeting just shortly before. I should never watch those meetings, but I did. And the Finance Committee selectmen talked probably an hour back and forth about the schools, with no one at the school there, making sure, checking the accuracy of the information. It goes out to all the public, accepted as fact, because they said it was so. Mm-hmm. And just this year, we were not invited in at all. I felt like it was not good communication, but I still thought we were probably okay. And then to go to town meeting floor, and your figure is not recommended. It's an $8,900 difference. Mm-hmm. And I find that embarrassing, that professionals, committees, come to town meeting floor for $8,900. It was a clerical thing, right or wrong.
It was correct.
And you were correct.
We were correct.
Or she were correct.
Patty's never wrong.
I know.
No, I am wrong. We won't say that. I'm 98.5% accurate.
I just found it embarrassing.
It was embarrassing.
There and for $8,900.
I will tell you, the most frustrating piece was the amount of time that Patty and I had spent individually with that member trying to make them understand that our figures were correct. We had not been invited to the meeting. And it was discounted. And it is disheartening. It is very disheartening. I was hoping that it wouldn't play out in a public setting on town floor. I'm glad that the townspeople decided to put the figure back in the budget. But, you know, well, I'm leaving, so I guess I can say this.
But you still have to live here.
I know. But we're hired because of our experience and expertise in education and developing a budget and a plan for the district. And that includes all aspects of the district. So we're not just throwing things out there. I don't go in and second guess my banker on financial things. But I think there is a perception that because everybody has been to a school in their life, that anybody can run a school. And we are constantly being second-guessed on decisions that we make. So, I've said my piece.
Thank you. Patty handled it beautifully.
Oh, thank you.
You were the voice of reason for anyone there that...
Yes.
Yeah, that.
Well, and to just go with what Marty's saying is that we've all had a classroom experience, but my classroom experience is different than my mother's, different from my grandmother's, and what my child is going to have is going to be different. So why don't people understand we're not talking about educating you, we're talking about how to educate these children today, not 20, not even 5 years ago. It changes constantly. And they don't appreciate the fact, I think, that not only administration, but there are teachers and their continual learning. I don't think teachers get enough respect mm-hmm. for their constant turning over of how to learn how to teach the children that sit before them. And it does get frustrating.
So I don't know how to reach out to the finance committee, or I mean, I was going to write my own letter, but I'm usually pretty careful about not any one of us can represent the committee. I don't want to, mm-hmm. you know, so I can't speak for others, and I don't want to give that impression. So that's why I thought, well, I'm just going to bring it here and see how that particular thing doesn't happen. I mean, we can debate any budget, and the town only has so many dollars, and whatever the town votes, the doors will open, because you'll make it work. But that kind of an error, I thought, was...
We have a new select board, and perhaps there's going to be a new approach to things, and I think the finance committee is being reorganized as well. One of my goals was to make sure that we had as much open communication and opportunities for conversation as possible. I will say it's worked beautifully in the other three towns. We have had less success in Deerfield. So, I don't know what you want to do, Mr. Chair.
Well, I think part of what occurred on town meeting floor was it wasn't just school budget that was embarrassing. The whole process was embarrassing. through the two nights, and it's as much a reflection on the inexperience of the town administrator and the new finance committee chair in terms of how to have the open communication that had been a little mm-hmm. more prevalent the last few years. So I think in some fairness to the Board of Selectmen, the Finance Committee, they've had turnover in their people. They had a new chairperson, they had new members. We had a new town administrator. The previous town administrator moved on mid-year, just at the start of budget season. And so the interim administrator, I think, learned a lot about the pieces that need to fall mm-hmm. into place and the processes that need to be followed. You could hear it in the conversation regarding the select board salaries versus the board of assessors salaries. So as people move on and history leaves the various boards and committees, it gets very difficult. And I think that contributed mm-hmm. in a large way to what we had to go through. It was unfortunate the $8,700 or $8,900 hadn't had the foresight to sit down and invite the school committee and school committee representatives in to talk about the budgets. So
well, they might have, and but Marty they didn't notify
tried,
us.
Right, well, Marty tried to show up when she could, when she received emails or texts from...
Yes, you're being thrown under the bus. Get down there.
Get down there. So,
but even so, that was would have been an invitation to the two of you.
Right.
This is a school committee budget.
Right. Mm-hmm. Right.
Yes. No, we've always had the opportunity to discuss the budget.
Yeah.
And perhaps it's partially my fault for not reaching out and saying to them, when are we going to meet, to remind them that we usually did that. So... we won't let that happen again next year.
I'll make a note.
I'm sure you will. So, but thank you for the work on the budget and for putting together one that was so well within the needs of the town this year and still manages to keep our staff intact and provide the support mm-hmm. and services that you guys need. Folks need in the school. So, new business. Discussion and vote on policy sections D through J. Anybody want to take them home for light reading?
So,
come on, Mary. I'm betting your hand goes up.
Through every word.
This is section D through J, the revised section. It's half as big as the original section. I will tell you that the policy subcommittee met for the last time last night. And we have now gone through the entire policy committee book. I have copies for your reading pleasure. Okay. Nobody else has taken one, so I'm hoping that I have to carry these home.
I'll take them for you.
Thank you, Patty. They worked diligently. This was the most difficult section because J is extremely long. It's a section all about students. But I think the process went very well. I had a very committed committee. I thank Mary for showing up all the time. I think we learned a lot. The discussion was good. And I feel good about leaving you with a revised policy book. I honestly wasn't sure if we'd get through the whole thing in a year, so.
I'm astounded you did.
So we did.
I know the years that I served on the policy committee, we never chewed off that much, so thank you, Mary.
Yeah. And Marty, we wouldn't have gotten it through in a year if you hadn't pre-read everything and been through everything.
I'm now an expert on district policy. So you don't have to do it now, but I would ask the committee to vote to approve policies D through J.
I move that we approve policies D through J.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Any further discussion? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
It's unanimous.
Thank you.
Discussion and vote on the ratification of the 2016-2019 teachers agreement.
Yes, I have both of those before you. And I will also tell you, this was my first experience at negotiating. And my committee, it was interesting because they were all men and me. And then only two of the committee members had ever been on, had negotiated a previous contract. And David was our representative from Deerfield. And so I wasn't sure what to expect. And we had a very large teacher representation committee. I thought it was well represented throughout the district. I thought it was very respectful, thoughtful. We had, I thought, good open discussions. It went on a long time. I will say it started in October and didn't end till March. So it was very lengthy. The highlights of the agreement, I can start with the salary. All of the teachers and IAs understood our concern for budgetary reasons this year to keep it at 1%, and then it went 2.5 after that. There were some legal language that needed to be cleaned up from the previous contract and also from what had occurred through the state. We also found that our head teacher, of which there are four in the district, were woefully underpaid compared to surrounding districts. So we did increase that. There were not major significant changes to the language. Yeah, there was a new salary column, a master's plus 45 or CAGS. So far, I think we have eight teachers who were able to take advantage of that. There were no areas that I thought had major significant impact to our budget other than the salaries increases. So those were the highlights. The instructional assistants, their biggest concern was to have equalized pay. That was one of their driving factors. The instructional assistants also asked to have included in their contract that all instructional assistants stay for early release Fridays unless they were sick. They no longer could just leave and not be paid. They felt strongly that for the rotation of childcare on the early release Fridays that there were some people who never stayed, and that reduced the number of people who could be tapped into overseeing the childcare, and they wanted the pool to be larger. So that was their request. We granted that. And rightfully so, they asked to be paid for the half day before Thanksgiving. Our teachers are all paid for that, and I thought that was certainly reasonable for the IAs. So I have presented the contracts to Conway and Whately, and so you were the third committee to see those.
And it has been ratified by?
It has.
The association.
By the association.
So, just so we're clear.
So it's just, we need the school committee chair to sign.
And they have to vote.
Pardon?
And they have to vote.
We need to vote to ratify the agreement for the Deerfield School Committee.
You want to do them all together?
Why don't we
do two separate votes, please?
Sure. I'll move that we approve the Teachers, Union 38 Teachers Association contract.
Second.
2016-19. We have a motion and a second. Any other discussion? I hear none. All in favor?
Aye.
It's unanimous.
And then I'll move that we approve the contract with the Instructional Assistance Association for the next 3 years.
Second.
Motion in a second, and any discussion? Don't see any. All in favor?
Aye.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Then we have a discussion of non-union salary recommendations. I don't see a vote.
No, we're presenting them tonight, and you will vote in June. We started doing that last year when some committees said, you know, we bring them to us in June on the last night without having a chance to look at them. So we've decided now we'll bring them to you in May. So there's two pages, three pages. Two are stapled together. Those are the people in Deerfield, the building itself, that are non-union. And the second page is the administration at central office. Everyone is recommended at 2% with two exceptions. Janet Serajenko.
Serretico.
I can never get that name right. Was, when we hired her last year, was promised a bump when she finished her bachelor's degree, which she did this past month. So she was given a $3,000 raise. And the other exception is Mr. Scott Paul, our IT director, and I'm going to let Superintendent Barrett address that.
I have recommended that he have a 5% increase, and I want to explain why. When he took over for our district, and I say this and people think I'm being dramatic, but I'm not. We were so close to having the system totally crash that it was an incredible burden that he decided to accept. He has built a team that is responsive, that has our equipment up and running, has put together plans for 3 to 5 years. I don't know of any other central office position that affects our entire district as much as his position. And when I did a look around at other districts and what they were paying their IT people, it was way below what we had. And I know that this can be a sticking point for people when you single out one particular person. I understand that. But the job that he's done and the job that he is continuing to do with our new student information system, and the fact that none of these people receive steps, they have nobody, you know, they're not in the union, they don't have anyone really lobbying for them other than me. And so I would ask that you give some consideration when you vote on this next month.
I just see, sometimes I am wrong. There, I did want to make one other clarification. On the school lunch salaries and the after-school program, our beginning salaries are $10 and $10.50. January 1st, minimum wage goes up to $11. So these positions were adjusted by 2% plus a dollar so that we are competitive with minimum wage. So the numbers in yellow, the first number there, the 5,059, that is what will impact our budget. The rest are grant or school choice. The two revolving funds would be $905 added to school choice. The $4,886 would come from the school lunch fund, and the $9,874 for after school program comes from the tuitions that the families pay.
So we'll bring it back to you in June for a vote. You can examine this further at your leisure.
Okay. Thank you. That brings us to reports.
I didn't hear what you said.
Oh, did I forget to give you a financial report?
Yes, you did.
Sorry.
Committee Chairman, I don't have any report to provide, and our other primary committee member is not here. So we're down to the principal's report.
So each of you should have a copy of the principal's report for this month. A few things that Clay and I wanted to highlight. First, we had our kindergarten screening last Friday. And this was a process that we had revamped last year. with suggestions and recommendations from the kindergarten teachers at that time. And it has proven to be a successful process, a really smooth process. We had families coming in. Our kindergarten students, our current K students, do not attend school that day. The incoming students come and the parents sign them up for about an hour slot. And we had pretty much an army of people working together to assess these students, to get their eyes on the children. And just meet families, make families feel comfortable, and it really was a great team effort. What we will do this Friday is sit together and debrief, talk about the assessment results. Kim McCarthy is actually, she's already provided us with the results in a spreadsheet form, and then we'll use that information to help us create well-balanced classrooms. So we'll see how things go, but it really was a very smooth process, and thanks to the hard work of all of our team members and teachers and instructional aides.
How many kids were screened? Do you know how many?
We had all but two show up, so that would be 44.
44.
Yep.
Wow. You had 44 show up?
We did. We had nine families come at once. So, and we worked all day long from 8:30 until 3:15. So
okay.
We squeezed a lot in. It was really, it ran very smoothly.
Do you have a new teacher yet?
No. We interviewed today, so we're still trying to go through that process.
So I get to talk about something that's been going on all week, Teacher Appreciation Week, and you know, the driver behind this is our wonderful PTA. It's hard to really be able to express the appreciation we have, Janine and I, and the PTA has for our teachers, because we all know how hard they work on behalf of the children. So this week is a big deal. One of the things is on Monday morning, people came, there was a giant chalk message in the front of the school that washed away, of course, because it rained all day Monday. But it was there at the beginning of school, and it was a really nice message. All throughout the building, you'll see stars with teachers' names on them. And today was the lunch, which is also, you know, one of the great things is it's a catered lunch and it's Mexican food, which is something you can't get in town here in South Deerfield. So it's a really a treat. And we want to thank our PTA and let's see, just April and anybody else from the PTA? You know, it's a great time, and a small way we can show our appreciation for our teachers who deserve a lot more. But
I have to point out Jessica Barnes, because I was here on Sunday and she was in the building, running through the building, and she had her children with her. There were 90 stars that she made, and spread them out through the entire building, set up the teacher's lounge, and it just was. And she was so excited about it.
Names on stars?
Yes.
Yeah. So they're all over
and
the hallway.
There were some sayings and some posters, and it was just really, it was a very welcoming, and just no matter what corner you turned, there was something there that just put a smile on your face.
And she's done it the past 3 years.
Yeah.
She really loves doing it.
She does love doing it. She was very excited.
You're not there for months.
Yeah.
And you guys are most deserving.
And can I ask, who prepares the lunch?
It was Veracruzana, yeah. And we actually had Marty. They were staff. There was staff there that served, and they kept refreshing the food, and it was lovely.
Staff from Veracruzana, you know, and yes.
Yes, yes, it was lovely.
I'll have to drive by next year.
Yeah, next time you should come.
I don't think other schools have that.
Yeah.
Well, Kristen Gordon was here, the new principal of Conway, so she had visited, and I was trying to get her to go in there. And made her, Deerfield's a really great place. We have these wonderful lunches every day.
You're cruel.
Yeah. The last thing I really want to highlight is, and I've shared with you at other school committee meetings, we've been really emphasizing and talking a lot about the new Second Step program and some of the changes, and we have a bullying prevention team that's been working with classroom teachers at different grade levels to be able to support them so we can support our students. And I had mentioned before, we've been dealing with some cyberbullying issues, and we wanted to be able to do something outside that was an extension of the second step. And we are continuing to look at our practices using some lessons from teaching tolerance. But one of the things that we did just recently on the 30th of April, we had students from PVPA, the Pioneer Valley Performing Arts Charter School. Their teachers and their students came, and they spent an entire morning with our sixth graders. They have been really working on diversity. They attended, and I have some notes on the report that you see, the National Conference for Community and Justice, and really trying to promote inclusion and acceptance and respect for all. So when it was, the amount of engagement that our students had the entire morning, I was really impressed with it. The students from PVPA, they led PowerPoint presentations, many workshops. They had them engaged in team building activities. They established group norms. And, you know, young adults were incredibly articulate in every aspect. And I was truly impressed with how they led these sessions. And it was a really great partnership. I have to commend Lisa Gaylor because she was the one that really organized this. Her daughter was a part of it, who was a former Deerfield student. And I'm speaking with Lisa afterwards. We're hoping this can be something that we can continue each year, because I just found it to be very powerful. So I want to thank Lisa again publicly for her hard work with that. And that's all I have.
Can you want to piggyback on something you said about something else that happened with Frontier students coming in?
Yes. Mm-hmm. Can you talk about that, Denise?
There was a panel of Frontier students that also came in and talked about digital citizenship to our fifth graders. And we're role models and had a panel discussion with them about ways to interact with each other online and social media and how technology improves their lives, but also some of the safety things and just how to communicate. And so I think it's just another great example of having young adults be good role models. And they were students who had graduated from here. And when I talked to my fifth graders, their response was, it was great to hear it from them because they live like we do and they understand us. And so I think it was a really great outreach. And Maureen Belcha oversaw that.
Yes.
And
yeah.
Really made a positive impact, I think, for those high school kids too.
Right.
My son being one of the Frontier kids, it really turned his day around and made him feel good, like that he was contributing to something positive.
And that was something that Maureen actually brought to every elementary building in the union. So certainly kudos to her. So thank you for bringing that up.
And I talked to Maureen yesterday because I've heard about it throughout the whole district.
Yeah.
And it is something that she's hoping to expand upon again for next year, because I heard from kids, I heard from parents, I heard from other teachers. It was,
yeah,
it was very good.
Superintendent's report.
Sure. So I passed out to you a report. I just want to keep this in the forefront. The Rural Consortium of Committee of Superintendents, we're continuing to meet. We meet again May 9th. We have made several recommendations to our local legislators. I did construct a letter on behalf of the Whately School Committee that include the following suggestions. Districts would be responsible, and this is primarily in reference to lifting of the cap on charter schools. Districts would only be responsible for $5,000 for an outgoing charter student. And we'd send that amount to the charter school, and the difference in the per pupil cost would be assumed by the state. So that would be along the same lines as choice. Charter providers must first consult with a local superintendent to discuss any actual need for a charter prior to the charter school being established. Charter schools must have local representatives to serve on its board of directors, and increased oversight on charter enrollment, financial impact, and student retention rates. However, recently in the past week, Representative Alice Peisch and Senator Sonia Chang Diaz have both come out and said that despite everybody's efforts on not having the charter cap lifted, they do not think that there is going to be any appetite to have legislation this year. Again, I saw today there's more conversations going on about urban charter versus rural charter. And I don't know if they're trying to separate the conversations, but that's the sense that I'm getting. So time will tell, but I'm not expecting any legislation this year. And as you know, pretty much we've talked about this. We spent the month of April discussing and defending budgets, as Patty mentioned. Three of the four budgets towns have met, and we also have the frontier budgets. And I just wanted to mention district-wide principals have been aggressive in trying to make hiring decisions early so we can take advantage of the best pool of candidates. I've been very, very impressed with the pool of candidates that have applied to our district. And I hear things from the candidates like, this is a highly desirable district, I really want to be here. And I know you say that in a cover letter, but the proof is in the number of applications. We've had elementary positions that have been advertised that have had anywhere from 60 to 110 applications. So you don't have that in a district that's not desirable. So kudos to everybody on that. So that's what I have.
Well, you get 60 to 100?
For one position.
For one position?
Yep.
How do you even begin that first cut?
Well, you go through the first line because many of them aren't qualified.
Okay. Or they're from Hawaii.
Or they're from Hawaii.
President's from Hawaii. What are you saying?
And so you can go through and chop those off right away. And then you have to go through based on what you're looking for. You know, but it's a process, and our principals have it down pretty well.
So, can I just go back to the charter? Does this mean that it's now up for a referendum? Isn't there something about if they didn't do legislation?
Yeah, it's on the ballot, but they had hoped to have a recommendation. It is on the ballot
already for this fall.
Yes. Mm-hmm. But I am seeing more and more people recognizing that there is a big difference between charter schools in urban areas.
Sure, yeah.
And where there are more failing schools, or potentially failing schools, than there are charter schools in rural areas. They have a different impact, and they're created for different reasons. So I don't know if our legislators are finding that more politically appealing or not. But I do think that, you know, talking about a different way of funding it would be helpful. And I really would like you to take these policies.
I'll take one.
Thank you.
I just got rid of the enormous binder.
I know.
I have one additional question, query to ask of the committee. I've been approached by a resident of the town of Deerfield who has an aunt who is turning 100 years old this year, and she taught at Deerfield High School back in the 40s for about 15 years. And he's asked if I'd be willing to send a letter for some acknowledgement from the Deerfield School Committee. And with the committee's approval, I would at least take that step.
Is it a surprise, or can you say the name?
I don't know the woman's name. Oh. It's Bob Decker's aunt.
Oh, okay.
So Bob is supposed to be getting me the information. Because Deerfield High School doesn't exist anymore, and Frontier wasn't really Deerfield. He was thinking the Deerfield School Committee, it would be nice if we could somehow recognize her on her 100th birthday.
She's still a Deerfield resident?
No, she lives in Florida. But that would be even better, is to get her into school.
We'd get her a cupcake or something.
And if I get the information, I might pass it along to Janine and see if the school, at least the elementary school, wants to do something, or to get it to Frontier.
It'd be nice if the kids
had a card.
Yeah.
Do you have an aerial photo, since we're having the roof redone? That we
can... No. If you get me a private plane, I'll take one.
Okay.
I'll bet you can find someone with a drone that would take the picture for you.
But, didn't we talk about that when the playground was being built, that we were going to get an aerial photo? I seem to remember. somebody volunteered to take it.
No, I think that would be, do you need a vote?
That's awesome.
No, I just, if I've got a consensus, I sort of had indicated to him I would do that.
Right.
I did want the committee to know before I did it. What's that?
Sounds good.
Yeah, so I can entertain a motion.
I'm still doing pictures.
I've got to sign them.
You're slipping on your...
Motion to adjourn?
Motion to adjourn, we have a motion in the second.
You made a motion.
Yeah.
I'm not telling you, you weren't paying attention?
I'm not, I wasn't.
David?
Okay.
Mary, second.
Thank you.
All in favor?